Hi, this is Carl Turner reporting for Pixels and Pills from the DTC National Conference. And I have here with me Mike Bloxam. He actually works at Ball State University. And Mike made a very great presentation about media consumption and media habits for consumers. So I wanted to get him to reiterate some points that he made in his presentation. You talked a lot about the video consumer study. Can you tell us a little bit about what that is and the methodology that was used?
Sure. The video consumer mapping study was a $3.5 million study, and it was commissioned by the Council for Research Excellence. And that's a group of Nielsen's biggest, some would say most important clients, media owners, agencies, advertisers combined. And they are given funds by Nielsen to spend in pursuit of a system for developing metrics for buying and selling video on any platform that's capable of delivering it. At the moment, we have very good metrics for television, but we don't have good and consistent video metrics for online, for mobile, for out-of-home, etc. And the council put out an RFP, and a number of people responded, and among ourselves, and we put forward a proposal using an observational research method, which we developed at Ball State University, whereby we shadow people for an entire day, from as soon as we can get to them after they get out of bed, to as close to their bedtime as we can stay with them. And we record during that entire day where they go, who they're with, which media they use, and what kind of life activities they're involved in. And we capture all of that in 10-second increments, because the device we use automatically refreshes every 10 seconds and captures any changes. So we'll know, for example, if you're at the office, if you're using your computer, what you're using your computer for. So you might be word processing, or you might be browsing the web, or you'll be using email. But we'll also know that you've answered a phone call, or you've made a phone call, or that you're reading a newspaper, and you might be eating as well as working. So we can combine all of those things. So you can see it becomes extremely layered and extremely complex set of data that's very granular as well. Uniquely so, because in effect, what we get is probably the most comprehensively cross-platform data set of any media study anywhere, but it's all gathered from the same people in the same place at the same time, and that's one of the things that makes it unique.
Okay. As you were going over your data, you used an interesting term. I really liked that, platform promiscuity. So I just wanted you to talk a little bit about that and why that's so important, especially when you're looking across age groups.
Sure. Platform promiscuity is really all about how many media do people have, if you like, relationships with? Do they use on a frequent basis, and for what extent? It's a conventional wisdom that younger people use more media. That's what people say. And they multitask more frequently. It's not actually necessarily true. What you tend to find is that people will use lots of different media. They might use different combinations of media. But when you look at the extremes, when you look at an 18 to 24 year old average versus a 65 plus average, you tend to find that in an average day, if you want to break out the media they spend, say, 10 minutes or more with, you'll find the 18 to 24 year old spends that amount of time with 10 different media versus somebody who's 65 plus, who typically spends that amount of time with only 5 media. So there you do see a degrees of difference in promiscuity and some degree of difference in the platform, but the core platforms are the same. The first 5 platforms are pretty much the same for everybody.
Okay, you also talked about contextual moments and really leveraging those. Can you talk about the importance of contextual moments?
Yeah, contextual moment is really pulling all of those different things together and understanding which media are in play, when, where people are when they're using it, what else they're doing, who they're with, what kind of mood state they might be. Are they feeling relaxed? Are they feeling alert? Are they in a good mood, a bad mood, and so on? So that you can understand which message is contextually appropriate. You know, we all understand that the brand usage has its context. You know, when is the right time to kick back and have a certain type of drink? There's a different context for coffee versus a Coke versus a brandy. But at the same time, messages have context as well. This is when people are open to different kinds of messages because they have different kinds of needs. And one example I use is if you think about a grocery shopping trip. We need to understand what they're doing in the 2 hours before that, what they're doing while they're in the grocery store, and what they're doing after that, say for another 2 hours, both in terms of what media they're using, but also which activities. It's pretty obvious the car is going to feature in it, but what else? And if they're in media, which car? If they're in the car, which media? Is it the radio? Is it a CD? Is it an MP3 player? What is it?
So are there any other implications from your research for marketers that you'd want to drive home?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of implications, one of which I'd say is, well, we tend to think about this work as being media-centric. It informs media planning and buying and budget allocation. It's much, much broader than that, because you can strip out all of the media information and then say, let's look at this from a strategic planning or product development point of view, because you are getting the information about how product categories fit within people's lives, because that's something else we're able to get access to with regard to the combination of the observational work we do and the e-diary sample, where people actually fill out an e-diary survey every 30 minutes, every 60 minutes. And we are recruiting from a sample where we can understand what their product purchasing patterns are. Then we start to see how all that fits together. So as a result, you end up with a very, very rich data set, which isn't only applicable to one side of the business, the marketing side, huge and important though that is. It applies to the real fundamentals about business division development and product development as well.
Okay, in terms of places where people can go to find more about your research, find out more about your research, and also access some of the data that you have available, where can they go?
Well, to find out what we do at Ball State, they can go to bsu.edu/CMD for Center for Media Design. And if they want to find out about the video consumer mapping study, then they need to go to the website for the Council for Research Excellence. And that website is www.researchexcellence.com. And they've got an enormous amount of data there. It's all in the public domain. And there's more reports being produced in the coming weeks there as well.
Great speaking with you. The conference actually goes on for another day, so if you're in the D.C. area and you're interested in coming by, registration is still open. I'm Carl Turner, reporting for Pixels and Pills from the National DTC Conference.